Time to get underway with the final round of the Swiss Tourism for the Asia Pacific Winter Playoffs. I'm TJ, joined by That's Admirable, to bring you guys the action. And I am pumped because we have a pretty cool match coming up. It's Karakute versus Tansoku. And these two players have some big stories behind them.
Yeah, we're just all over the bubbles here in this round. This is a big one for players to make it or break it, where they find themselves in that top eight or not. Tansoku comes in as a 5-1 record into our final round, round number 7, a long day of grueling play. Karakute comes in as a tavern hero, one of the first tavern heroes that we've seen break through to have a great performance stand out in this spot. I believe Snail from Winter Championships last year and Twist from EU, who was unable to make it to the championship due to visa issues, was in those two spots. I mean, this is an incredible story, too. It'd be our first female top 8 competitor as well.
Yeah, she's also the only player playing from the Philippines, I believe. So that's another good story. The Philippines really hasn't had too many players to put themselves on the map besides Staz. Staz is a competitor who's been around for a long time. But Karakute, again, trying to bring Philippines back on the map. Tansoku participated in the last call. He's one of the top point earners for 2016. So he's no stranger to the competitive scene either. He's no stranger to the grind. Playing a lot of matches, definitely an experienced player on camera as well. So this should be a big one, and it's starting to get down to the point where the tiebreakers are going to be so close for all of the 5-2 players. So if Karakute makes it that 5-2 point, if she defeats Tansoku, that's two more players that are in the mix for that 5-2 slot, which means there's going to be a lot of people biting their nails at the end of this round to see who's going to make it through.
Yeah, and that's really the big prayer here for Karakute. It's actually very fortunate that she's been paired up with an opponent. Paired with an opponent has a better record than she does currently. It's at 4-2 for Karakute, now playing its 5-1 with Tansoku. This win is going to boost that tiebreakers just a little bit. Now, she did pick up two losses fairly early on, so this win will leave her with a prayer at that top eight, but a slightly smaller field than we've seen in the previous playoffs here so far. Maybe there's a chance.
Yeah, if you look at sort of her opponents thus far, she's pretty much everybody down the line is like 3-3. She's played against Chunsu, she's played against AHQ Roger, and both those guys I think are about even in the standings right now. So right now her tiebreakers are very even.
Yeah, and that could be a big benefit depending on the way that they're breaking down throughout the course of this. If your opponents continue to play out all the rounds and just put up poor results, that's usually a little bit bad for your tiebreakers. But that's the nature of competition. The strength of your opponents should be the first tiebreaker. If they all did poor, maybe that's the reason you were picking up a couple extra wins.
Yeah, Tansoku can just straight up secure himself a spot in that top eight with a win here. 6-1 guarantees you a spot in the top eight, which means you're one match away from going to the Bahamas. And again, another player from Japan. We've talked about it a lot. Japanese players represent a third of the field right now, and there's a lot that are in contention for that top eight. It's very likely that we'll be guaranteed one Japanese player in the Bahamas, and with that country's history in card games, it's actually no surprise that they're starting to dominate in Hearthstone in the Asia Pacific region. We've had Japanese representation at almost every single big event, spreading all the way back to Kano in the World Championship in 2015. We had Matsune make it pretty far in his run in 2016 in the championship there. So maybe Tansoku can put his name on that and qualify, but we'll have to see. It looks like the players are getting pretty close to jumping into the game. We've heard that they've already done their pick and ban process. They have their decks queued up for that first game, so we should be jumping into the start of round 7 momentarily here.
Yeah, I am a little bit, if we take a look at the lineups, I am a little bit worried for Tansoku's lineup as he matches up against Karakute. He's got a druid build that's focused around Malagos Arcane Giants with two Ancients of War to protect himself. He does have a copy of Harrison Jones, which is very good against what Karakute's brought. He's got Aggro Rogue, but his Aggro Rogue has Beneath the Grounds in it. There are no Reno Mages or Reno Warlocks in Karakute's lineup. If you look at his Aggro Shaman build, it's fairly standard. It's likely to be banned. And his Warrior build is what looks like to be an identical mirror with what Karakute's brought as well. There's a copy of Bash and no Mortal Strikes in her lineup, or in his lineup. And in Karakute's lineup, she's got Tempo Mage, Ragnaros, and Archmage Antonidas in there. So that could pull some weight versus Druid. Her Aggro Rogue does not have Beneath the Grounds. She's got Undercity Huckster as well. That little bit of extra value could mean a difference in that matchup. Like I said, Pirate Warrior with Bash and no Mortal Strike. And then her Aggro Shaman's fairly standard. So again, pretty likely to be banned away in most scenarios. And as we kick it off with Tempo Mage versus Pirate Warrior, this can be a bit tricky for the Pirate Warrior.
Yeah, this one is, you know, we've seen how Tempo Mage, I believe it originated in China earlier on this year, late last year, where they started to play Tempo Mage, you know, earlier than all the other regions, in particular to have good matchups against Control, while also making sure that they have decent matchups against Agrotex, Pirate Warrior included. They have a terrible matchup against Shaman, but if you build your lineup around banning Shaman, which both of these players have done, then, you know, really the only aggressive deck you're looking at to have to beat is that Pirate Warrior. And with Mirror Image and, you know, Flame Waker, especially since Karakut's on the coin, if she can pick up Flame Waker, she can have one stabilization turn, Mirror Image to block weapon charges. You can really start pushing on the damage and have a good matchup against Pirate Warrior.
Yeah, it does come down to that key swing turn, though. The Tempo Mage can get some blistering fast starts, but for the most part, it's a deck that's looking for swing turns in the early stages of the game. And Flame Waker, as you mentioned, is a big tool for that. Karakut doesn't have Flame Waker, nor does she have an early game minion. So her main goal is going to be simply to fend off the pressure that Tansoku is going to throw her way. If she can pick up, say, a Water Elemental or a Flame Waker, those are about the best ones it gets. But she's under a ton of pressure early on from this great start from Tansoku.
Yeah, even though upgrade's not the best to, you know, just play without a weapon, it is a weapon. So it's going to be able to activate Small Time Buccaneer. It's able to allow Tansoku to get out that Saucy deckhand, start pressure for damage. Also, with Blood Cell Cultist, any type of weapon, you know, big or small, is a good pickup for Tansoku. So he can, you know, start getting those charges rolling with Blood Cell Cultist and start pushing that damage.
Yeah, I mean, outside of Mirror Entity, Karakut's going to have no way to protect her life total. So she's got to play conservatively very early on. That's one of the reasons you're seeing this Frostbolt just on a one-cost minion here. She's got to cut the damage, and this Bloodsail Cultist is going to compound the issue.
Yeah.
The heavier hand and the very little action early on and the great start from Tansoku is probably going to spell this game. Flamewaker is looking like the card to draw.
Yeah, now taking a look at Karakut's run throughout the bracket, she lost early on, which is usually a bad sign when it comes to tiebreakers. You'll hear us mention tiebreakers, and for those of you who are not aware, the way we determine the top eight is by the players with the highest record. But a lot of players will be tied at 5-2 towards the end. So the way that's determined of which players make it to the top eight out of the 5-2 players is their strength of schedule. How good the players that they've played against, that they either won or lost against, did in the rest of the tournament. And right now, Karakut, even though she lost early on, there's a lot of players that are in that list right now, including like Pomblad, Chunsu, who are actually doing okay in the bracket. So if she's able to beat another good opponent, another player with a good record, like Tansoku, that would bode well for a tiebreaker. It's not guaranteed if she wins, but it puts her, she will have a chance to make it. So that's sort of that big cut that we're looking for. And it would be a pretty historic moment in Hearthstone, not only for a tavern hero, but also the first female to make it to a championship, which would be huge.
Yeah, game one not boding so well. A second fireball picked up, and Frothing Berserker left to pick up the pieces of the lost damage from the mirror image. So the life total will continue to dwindle here. Second Fiery War Axe, Bloodsail Raider. And there's no healing in this deck, so it's only a matter of time, I think, until Tansoku gets there. It would take a miraculous series of events to win this game.
Yeah, and even though, you know, this matchup could go by the wayside and be a loss for Karakut, it doesn't mean she's out of the series by any means. Looking at the decks, as you mentioned, there's some mismatchups there. As far as lineups go, there's some decks that she can capitalize on with her aggressive lineup. So that's a big thing to note, is that just because game one lost to Pirate Warrior, as long as she keeps her cool, then she can still win the series quite easily.
Yeah, the big one to look at is just simply the aggro matchup in the mirror. There's a copy of Beneath the Grounds in Tansoku's deck that could come back to haunt him at some point. The Malygos Druid that he's brought, that deck typically has struggled to aggressive builds throughout its entire history. That's the nature of Druid. They spend their early time ramping. I think the copies of Arcane Giant can give him an edge in that matchup, but it looks to me like that is going to be the weak spot, is that Druid build he has. So if he gets a win with that one, I think he's fairly clear for the series, but that's the match to look out for sure.
Yeah, it looks like she's just going to go ahead and play the Blood Mage Thanos here. She's desperate to try and find something that's going to help her stabilize. She's going to need Flame Waker plus another cheap spell next turn and just hope that it's going to be enough, but it doesn't look like it's going to be. Only a little bit of damage here, and that's enough for Tansoku in a very quick game one win for a Japanese player here.
Yeah, the early removal lacking for Karakute. I mean, she's got to find Arcane Blast in the early game, these Mana Worms to help contest the board. When you start out against Buccaneer and there's no turn one play, that is a lot of damage that's going to pile up.
Yeah, one of our caster buddies, D2, who we saw at Championships last year, he's quite the connoisseur when it comes to the Asia-Pacific region and its players and its history. And, you know, when you talk to him about Tansoku, he has a lot of respect for him. And that's because he has great mechanical play. He's just a really consistent player overall. Doesn't try to do too many flashy things, but his deck lists here are a little bit different than what we'd normally expect from a player that just likes to bring the best stuff. But I like the way, you know, his strategy has panned out for most of the field. It's just going to be the question of whether or not the rest of his lineup, besides Pirate Warrior, can deal with aggressive decks.
Yeah, and honestly, Beneath the Grounds is the big one, and the Druid choice is consistent with that Beneath the Grounds tech choice. So I imagine he's been running into a lot of Reno decks.
Yeah, and it's round number 7. It's not just this match that's happening. There's a lot of other matches happening around the Asia-Pacific Winter Playoffs. Crumpled, we've seen a few times, is playing up against Palmblad. Both those guys have actually pretty good tiebreaker scores, so whoever wins that has a good chance of making it to that top 8. And, of course, Chimpira versus Foot, two more 4-2 players that are trying to win that spot for their chance at making it to that top 8. So lots of action happening across. That's three Warriors in those first games. Lots of players been liking to open up with that Warrior, trying to get that quick win out of the way, and a couple of Dragon Priests here with Foot playing it, and Crumpled also has that in his lineup. Such a small representation, kind of cool to see a couple of those still left in the running.
Yeah, Foot been a great Korean representative as well. He's had a great career behind himself, and oftentimes his hand looks just as good. So really looking forward to seeing if he can make that 5-2 record and find his way through. But it looks like game number 2 about to get started in our main match.
Yes, indeed. Both players look pretty calm. Yeah, that's a good thing. It's been a long day of games. These players have been at their venues for about 12 hours now, playing Hearthstone for about 10 hours now, coming up on 10 hours. By the end of the series, they'll be pushing 11 hours of Hearthstone.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it's been actually a long time since I've jammed 11 hours of Hearthstone. It's
been about a week for me.
Yeah, oh, actually, I've been playing Hearthstone this whole time, the whole broadcast. Let me just, got lethal here. Oh, we got a game. Okay, game number 2.
Yeah, I just finished 12-0 in my arena.
Nice.
Going after that top ranked score. So, Tempo Mage taking on the aggressive rogue build from Tansoku in this one. And he has an early key card. Shaku really brings the pain in this matchup.
And Small Town Buccaneer and Backstab. I mean, that's a good opening amp for Tansoku. If he picks up another good card, he might be able to run away with this game, but Karakute does have a good hand of her own. The only thing is that both of these decks thrive on the coin.
Yes, they very much do. With Mage having the spell interaction with Mana Worm and Flame Waker, being able to cheat the curve a little bit on 4, which is very much one of its power turns. The availability of Barnes and Frostbolt coupled with Hero Power, very big deals. And for Tansoku, this deck thrives not only with a coin, but with that extra card that he gets. This deck oftentimes will just relentlessly push damage, so having that extra resource could mean big things.
Yeah, you can see a small little wince there from Karakute as she has a good opening hand, but then draws Archmage Antoninus, and
that is
Tansoku draws the Endwind. Oh my goodness, and on the coin.
Yeah, this is a very weird draw for Tansoku, because I imagine he wanted to get started right away, but when he picks up this Edwin Van Cleef, it changes the entire dynamic of his hand. You may see him slow this down and kind of play a very similar style to what the Tempo Mage was described as in game one. Look for a really big swing early on, and if that huge Edwin sticks, that is a lot of damage he's going to buy. But looks like he wants to get started a little bit earlier here.
The one thing that you can't do is tunnel too hard on the Edwin Van Cleef. Sometimes it's better, especially in these aggressive matchups, to kind of act like you didn't draw it. He had such a good early curve. He had a good plan. He can deal with the Mana Worm this turn if he wants to. Maybe you try and, you know, wait a little bit longer before you develop that big minion. And
just play your strong stuff, and that's what he's going to do. I like that. You know, there was a chance that he could have like held on to small time up here.
Yeah, he would have gotten heavily punished if he chose to not backstab and attack the Manowar here as well. I think there was an option for him to simply wait. If he'd done that, he would have run straight into Arcane Blast and Mirror Image, and suddenly that Manowar would have just been lights out. It would have been a ton of damage picked up.
Also, he would have given himself more chances to draw patches. There's always that benefit of playing small time Buccaneer early to wait for it, thin your deck, Admirable. Deck thinning.
It's a big deal.
It is.
Very big deal. Every time you can pull a useless card out of your deck and continue to draw the better cards.
Whoa.
Slightly extra percentages.
Patches is not useless. You take that back.
He's not, but drawing him early on is oftentimes fairly useless. I think it's wonderful that one of the best legendaries in the game is one you never actually want to draw.
You wouldn't say that to patches that land.
The Shadow Step is beautiful. It's going to feed Tansoku's Edwin Van Cleef, and this might be too much for Karakute to handle. Once again, Tansoku with a massive early couple of turns.
Yeah, she's shaking her head. That is not the look of someone who thinks they have a good shot at winning the game.
I mean, turn to 8-8 Edwin Van Cleef.
Well,
there's not a card in Karakute's deck that actually contests this straight up.
Barnes into Rag.
It's a possibility, but that 8 damage is coming through first.
Yeah. Now, granted, the mage can stabilize quite well again at low health. If with Mirror Image, you can block pretty much everything that the rogue can do besides like crazy eviscerate plays, and Tansoku is running low on resources. But that is a weak turn.
I think there's a lot of consideration for Mirror Image in this spot. It has a potential to absorb eight damage and then perhaps 2 weapon charges from Tansoku. And if he chooses to weapon here, it means he's often not getting development. So not playing this Mirror Image, I think, is going to cost a lot of board position here for Karakute. His Barnes into Ragnaros is the dream play, and I think that's the direction she's headed with this.
Yeah, at some point, you just have to think, you know, how do I win this game? Do I have to go for the 1 in 10, or however many minions are left in her deck, it's probably about 10, to go for the Rag, and then also the 1 in 3 to hit onto the Edwin.
Flamewaker Mirror Image still looks appealing, but would leave her on the draw. Either way, she's going to need help from the gods to get out of this game.
The thing about Flamewaker plus Mirror Image is that, it blocks the attacks, but even if Flamewaker lives, what do you follow that up with? An Arcane Intellect?
Arcane Intellect into Frostbolt.
And then what do you follow that up with?
It's like keep drawing spells. That would be the game plan.
I think just Barnes into Rag is probably the best hope. It feels like a grim situation.
I agree with you, and that's one of the reasons I think I would have liked to see the Mirror Image last turn is try to protect that health as much as possible, especially if Barnes is the conclusion here. If it hits Ragnaros, there's now 2 reasonable targets for it, because again, Shaku's going to be pumping out card advantage as well, so this is a necessary risk. Not it.
Nope.
That's a Tomb Pillager drawn as well, so. For the man who has everything, also a 4-drop.
Acolyte of Pain will draw a card. But how much does that really matter?
I am a little bit surprised that he's choosing to attack this Acolyte of Pain. It does protect his Edwin from Fireball on the following turn. It would now require Barnes to run into Edwin as well. To take it out. Ink Master? Not good.
Well, I don't know. It could be.
I'll tell you what's good is that 16 damage that Edwin Van Cleef has brought so far.
Yeah. Kiki could really use a 5-mana Flamestrike right now.
Yeah. Or 5-mana Deathwing or something in that neighborhood. This was just way too strong of a start for Tansoku. And that's part of the benefit of aggressive decks is when they draw strong, they are nigh unbeatable.
So now it looks like Flamewaker Mirror Image maybe has to be the play just to keep her alive.
Yeah, I think there's some merit to attacking first with Barnes. Maybe take out the Shaku and hope that you can isolate the 2 higher power minions.
This, I think, might be a checkmate situation unless Mirror Image both shots go on to, or one shot goes onto the Tomb Pillager and she can trade in, but now there's not, so. Yeah, with Dagger Up plus Salcy Decking and Eviscerate, that should be it.
Yeah, it looks like it's it to me. That's 13 damage I count on board. And that Tansoku just had a fantastic early start. There's no coming back from an opening like that.
Yeah, that's just way too tough. Turn three, 8-8, Edwin Van Cleef.
Turn two,
8-8. Turn two, 8-8, Edwin Van Cleef. That's going to be tough to deal with. If Tansoku takes another quick game, game number two of two in the series, is Karakyu going to be able to swing the matchup and sweep the Druid with the aggressive lineup? It's definitely a possibility.
I think it's actually a fairly likely possibility. Again, his Druid deck is going to struggle to aggression fairly often. Ancient of War is really where his first defensive turn hits. Outside of that, it's Living Roots. It's Wrath. It's Swipe. It's Feral Rage. Those are the only things he has to protect himself. There's no Druid of the Claw. And there's outside of that, there's just not really a way to interact. A big Innervate turn could change it as well. But this is what aggressive decks prey on. It's decks that invest their early game into unlocking powerful turns later on and just end up falling from overwhelming pressure.
Now, I think that the matchup for this deck is a little bit better than, say, a matchup for Jade Druid or the C'Thun Druid that we've seen Jowen play a couple times, because it does have more spot removal early on. It runs Moonfires, Living Roots. You can use those to pick off some pirates or some of those early Temple Mage minions. So you can stabilize. And then, if you're using those cheap removals, you worry about running out of resources. But, with such huge minions to come off the top of the deck, Ancient of Wars, Arcane Giants, even just Nourishes can give you the gas that you need. So this is going to be a tall task for the Tavern Hero, Karakyu, to be able to come back and reverse sweep 3-0.
Yeah, I mean, Harrison Jones and Arcane Giant, I think, are two of the cards to really look at for Tansoku's build. If he manages to land a timely Harrison Jones and find some extra removal from that, if he can crank out spells in the early game and find himself a pair of Arcane Giants, that is definitely a way to counterattack. And that's the power that I think the Malygos decks provide, is that potential there. But just look at the starts early on. Tansoku's deck is loaded with high-cost cards. Karakute's looking to push that damage, and this Pirate Warrior hand looking a lot better than her previous two with the Tempo Mage. Tansoku, full mulligan.
See what he gets back. Looking for ramp and early spot removal.
Yeah, a nice early Innervate start would benefit him as well. I think one of the ways that Druid can run away with a lot of matchups is by Innervate Coin Fandral, and then having a Wrath or a Living Roots on the turn after. I think those are two of the big ones that Tansoku is looking for. A minion to contest the board early on, and then a spell to take advantage of alongside it.
Mm-hmm. Karakyu is still agonizing over these mulligan choices, and it is going to be a full keep.
Ooh, Harrison.
That's not that bad of an early start.
And honestly, the mulch is not the worst pickup in the world. It will handle either Frothing Berserker or South Sea Captain. Comes with a cost, of course, but the Harrison Jones could be a big factor in this game. If it lands on a weapon and he's not under a ton of pressure, that could be the key. But Karakyu's got Frothing Berserker in opening hand, and that is such a powerful card versus Druid.
Just really thinking about this early turn and looking at the lists, I actually kind of like the Nuzlocke First Mate first. It seems counterintuitive, but if you run into Living Roots on this turn, then you're kind of sad. If you had played Nuzlocke's First Mate and gotten patches, then you could have played the Small Time Buccaneer on an off turn, forced Tansoku to make the awkward decision of, well, do I Living Roots or do I Hero Power? Unless you pick up another one, then hey, it's the right play.
I personally like the Small Time Buccaneer first. It forces Tansoku to have Living Roots or Coin Wrath in on turn one to be able to answer that pressure.
Yeah.
She saw a full mulligan from Tansoku as well, so the likelihood that Living Roots is in the hand is just limited strictly to those four cards.
Very good point.
Plus the draw for the turn. I like the risk.
Now with three pirates on board, South Sea Captain's looking like a very appealing option going into turn four.
That swipe is gonna get negated here as well. So just a hero power from Tansoku, kill one of these pirates. South Sea Captain is the key though.
Whoa.
And that attack, this is honestly probably the right risk for Tansoku to take. He's telegraphing swipe here, and that will be his next turn play. But when he runs into the South Sea Captain, all those pirates get buffed, and they will not get killed by swipe in this instance.
Wow.
And that is a brutal turn. Look at his reaction.
Yeah. Now, again, I don't really think that, as you mentioned, that's probably a risk you have to take. This is a poor matchup.
You need to stifle that early board pressure. Frothy Berserker is also another minion that is likely to come down on turn three. If that's a Frothy Berserker and Karakute doesn't pick up a Saucy Cap in that situation, Swipeful clears that board. And I don't think Karakute's in a position where she can hold back something like that, but that is going to be a pretty big punish. And now Tansoku going to have to fight back, but already taking so much damage. He's at 16 health.
Now he does have Feral Rage, and he does have Swipe. And Refreshment Vendor is going to be very little use to Karakute, so that the replacement minion, not much, but Korokran Elite, not too shabby.
All right, so Frothing Berserker upgrade. She pushes 7 damage. Tansoku goes down to 9 with guaranteed 6 next turn.
I think I like the Korokran more. Your opponent just told you they had Swipe, so if they're forced to swipe the Korokran Elite, that means the Frothing Berserker won't be hit by that target, and Wrath will require him to take extra damage to take it out if that's what he has.
But it's the same situation if you play Frothing Berserker this turn, if the Swipe comes out, like you saw, then you just get free damage from the Korokran Elite and the Force.
Get the upgrade in.
Yeah, so it's, you know, the immediate damage from the Korokran Elite is still going to come in.
Small Time Buccaneer stays alive.
And it stays alive through the Swipe.
That's a big one. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's actually exact lethal. Wow. Great planning there. I didn't spot the exact lethal with the upgrade. I just forgot that the extra 2 damage stuck around.
Yeah.
So her turn two attack with the weapon. The upgrade perfectly timed here as well. The captain shutting off the Swipe. Every little thing came in big in this game.
Now that's damage efficiency right there. And Karakute starts to come back. One win with the Pirate Warrior. A really good matchup for her. So, you know, don't let that fool you. And smiles. First smile that we've seen.
Well, the first 2 games are brutal.
Yeah. I'd say so.
I wouldn't want to be in the receiving end of either of those 2 draws. Mm-hmm. Turn 2, 8-8. That's not a beatable thing, really.
Yeah.
You got to have some really strong cards to beat that. I'm thinking unnerfed Big Game Hunter is really the answer to that.
That's probably the only one, and we'll see. But, again, Karakute fighting for those tiebreakers, and these players fighting for that top 8, which means they're fighting for that spot at the Bahamas, which is going to be coming up in March, the Winter Championship, Global Championship. It's going to be pretty cool. It's going to be an awesome event, so let's go ahead and take a look.
The Hearthstone Championship Tour is heading to the Caribbean for the Winter Championships. Bring your beach towel and your best decks to the Bahamas. The Malia Nassau Beach Hotel will host the 16 worthy qualifiers from the playoffs. They'll be competing for a piece of a $2 million prize pool and a spot in the World Championships. It's Hearthstone in Paradise, the Winter Championships, March 23rd to 26th in the Bahamas.
All right, well, there's the 12 players that we currently have that are on their way to the Bahamas for that Winter Championship in March. A pretty stacked field, and we're waiting for the 4 from Asia Pacific to join them to round it off at 16. We're going to fight it out for that title of Winter Champion.
Yeah, just a couple rounds away.
Woo.
For some of these players. One of these players is 4 rounds away from claiming the Asia Pacific title.
Look at that beauty trophy. I'm going to steal it.
Me too. Let's team up.
We'll just cut it in half.
They'll never be able to use this broadcast for proof against us.
All right, well, let's go and move into game number 4 here. It's going to be the aggressive rogue for Karakute up against, once again, Tansoku's Druid. Yep. Will this deck be a liability for him against an aggressive matchup?
I think this is the deck that I had my eye on. And once again, a full mulligan from Tansoku. You're going to see that quite a bit as he looks for key early cards. And Karakute also getting the coin on her rogue side as well. And this hand is gas.
Yeah. There's like 24 cards in Tansoku's hand that he doesn't want to see in his opening.
Yeah. And they all cost 3 or more mana.
Yeah. It's pretty rough. You know, getting an Arcane Giant or an Ancient of War in your opening hand is bad news bears.
Yeah, and honestly, even some of the cards that cost under 3 mana in his deck just really don't fight that well. I think Wild Growth can certainly slow you down at times. Raven Idol, not the greatest card to draw. Moonfire usually has to be coupled with Hero Power. And Karakute's going to hold on to the backstab. I think that's fairly peculiar to hang on to. If you look at the build from Tansoku, Fandral Staghelm is the first minion that makes an appearance on the board.
Yeah, that's the cheapest minion in the entire deck, unless you count the 1/1 tokens from the living room.
Second backstab gets drawn.
Yikes. The living room on turn one is...
I like it a lot. It opens up the possibility to kill a small-time Buccaneer, and that's a super important thing for Tansoku.
Yeah. With two backstabs in hands, I find it pretty interesting that she didn't decide to backstab this 1/1.
I'm a little surprised by that as well.
It sets up just a clean kill for turn two on this small-time Buccaneer, which is, you know, a driving force in that early damage. Okay. Now she's going to have to rely on, you know, some of these slightly weaker minions to do that job.
Yeah, Huckster's still a totally reasonable play here, though. It will be giving her back a card at some point, and you can see Tansoku waiting for that turn four. Fandral, Innervate, Wrath available to him.
I was hoping he was going to go for a Wrath and the next turn Fandral and then a turn five Innervate a 10-10.
That's a possibility.
That would have been pretty cool. Naturalize!
That's actually a good pickup in this matchup. The minions from Tansoku are very heavy, so anytime that, say he Innervates out an Ancient of War, that suddenly is gone. You know, the two cards that Tansoku will pick up, there's not a ton of actual answers to the board position. That's a very reasonable tempo play.
Yeah, this is a pretty peculiar spot.
I think this is another missed opportunity. I would have liked to see that SI7 agent hit and start pushing damage. I mean, her main objective is to put as much pressure on Tansoku as possible. And Tansoku's going to slow down here. He's eyeing Ancient of War. Ancient of War could punish.
Tansoku is being incredibly patient with his resources here.
Hearts and Squires is a good pickup. That'll allow this SI7 agent to giddy up. And honestly, holding on to it bought her a very strong turn here. I mean, this really offset Tansoku's tempo plays here. He would have loved to use that Wrath on the prior turn.
Yeah, there's still an argument for last turn because you would have pushed three more damage at this stage in the game. No dagger up, but she didn't attack with the dagger last turn anyway. She would be able to dagger up this turn to be in the same spot just with Tansoku being at three less health, you know, from her perspective.
I think she definitely should be attacking in this spot too. She's got plenty of mana. Her cards are very cheap. This Ancient of War, it's going to get punished, and you can see
thumbs up
from Parakeet. Naturalize. Got to make quick work of this Ancient of War. That is big.
Yes, please, Tansoku. It looked like he felt physical pain from that naturalize.
I would too. That's brute.
Oh, jeez. Even though it gives him two cards, the thing about Tansoku's hand is that, as you mentioned, it's so heavy. He doesn't have the mana to be able to play all this stuff.
Druid doesn't fight well from behind. It's a deck that needs to go even on board and then rely on its power plays to get back into the game.
Fandral Wrath here can draw him a card, also a great removal. If Fandral sticks on the board, then Feral Rage next turn can not only gain a bunch of health, but also act as removal. So definitely stabilization potential here.
Fandral's not sticking to the board. Ooh. That's an Azure Drake.
Whoa! That's probably the best pickup, and I'd like to see utilization of these backstabs.
That's a lot of damage. Yeah, I would love to see backstab and for Karakute to actually just use her dagger here, but what she's counting up is, does she have lethal over two turns by simply pushing all damage to face?
Yeah, I think Eviscerate on this Fandral is a no-go. Backstab plus attack with dagger and the 1/1 is a potential. Maybe trying to dig with Huckster for additional damage and protect that Divine Shield on that 1/1 is also potential. So she's gonna dig. What is that?
It's a Celestial Dreamer, I believe it is. Gets +2/+2 on Battlecry if you have a 5 power or higher minion.
Cold Blood, that could make a 5 power minion. That could get interesting, but yeah, a 3-mana 3/3 is still reasonable.
Tansoku's in a lot of trouble. Heaps of trouble.
Yeah, he can do something like Mulch Feral Rage here.
He can stay alive for a little bit longer, but how does he actually get out of the situation?
Yeah.
Sure, he could not die for a while, but he's got to figure out a way to stabilize.
Let's see. Healing Touch.
That is 16 extra health now.
Is back at almost 30. Let's reset, but I have bigger stuff than you.
The problem is there's already 8 damage on board, so he's got to slow this down. So the Feral Rage will come at another time. And this Mulch, hey, that's a 3-man of 3-4. I'll take it.
Ah, bummer.
That's an Edwin Van Cleef. I'll take it. And she's just seen mulches from Tansoku at this point. So that Edwin Van Cleef is massive, and it's sticking around.
So Unearth, Raptor, Coin, Eviscerate, Edwin, and the next turn you get a 5-5 Celestial Dreamer.
I think there's a lot of merit to even backstabbing on the Argent Squire here. Just remove the Divine Shield to get +2/+2 on Edwin.
Yeah, there is a potential for that.
It's 8 mana now.
Or maybe you split the power and go Edwin first and then put the 2-2 on the Celestial Dreamer. Yeah.
Wow.
You go 6-6 Edwin and then 5-5 Celestial Dreamer. That might be better.
I think it is better.
Would you rather have a 3-4 and an 8-8 or a 6-6 and a 5-5?
A 6-6 and a 5-5. Form of Dragon. She's just stacking it all on Edwin instead. So the stat distribution is exactly the same in terms of number of stats she gets. It's just that it's piled on to Edwin Van Cleef at this point. So the only card that Tansoku could have to remove this is either A, hit with the Ragnaros, or B, the second Raven Idol into mulch.
Yeah, he only runs one natural mulch in the deck. This Ragnaros game would be huge.
It's game either way. If it, even if it hit the Edwin Van Cleef, the other Eviscerate was taking it out. It is now tied up game 5.
Ooh, that was some big pickups from those class card stealing cards from Karakute.
And timely Edwin Van Cleef.
Yeah, she's looking pretty pumped too.
Honestly, in this matchup, there's a potential for it to be better at a later stage than it is in the early stage, simply because of the risk of mulch. If she moves all in on Edwin Van Cleef early and runs into that mulch, that could be disaster. But at the time she picked it up, mulch had to hit an SI7 agent. The mulch found from Raven Idol had to hit Azure Drake. And then Edwin Van Cleef showed up. No way to contest it whatsoever.
Yeah, so now it's going to come down to Tempo Mage versus the Druid. Can Temple Mage beat this Druid too?
I think it can. There's a couple big things to look at in her Temple Mage deck. Number one is that she's got a little bit of extra card draw in here with the Acolyte of Pain and effectively with Barnes in a lot of situations. The second thing to look at is that Archmage Antonitis is in this deck. If Tansoku can't find pressure, that gives Karakute time to find Emperor Thorason, discount the hand, make a bunch of fireballs. Third one is Ragnaros. Ragnaros tends to be a very heavy hitting card versus Druid in general, but especially so when Arcane Giant is your prime source of attack. Any turn that Ragnaros is on the board, Arcane Giant is threatened by that. And with double Mana Worm in the opening hand, that is some heat.
That she's had some gas hands for these last three games.
I mean, Tansoku had him for the first two as well, and yeah. Honestly, Druid is a deck that just doesn't fight aggressive builds very well. He's trying to target slower Reno decks. The fact that she's brought an aggressive lineup is punishing here to the choice from Tansoku.
And Tansoku has a full mulligan for the third game in a row. That tells you something when you don't see a single card that you want to keep for three games in a row.
Yeah, Karakute already counting up damage, and that is a very important thing.
3, 6, 15, 30. Yeah, I got enough.
It's very important in these early stages because Mirror Image, I was just about to mention this, Mirror Image could be a big factor to her staying in this game in an aggressive manner. So how she sequences this early, is it going to be two Mana Worms on one? Is it going to be one Mana Worm and then the second plus the Mirror Image? Is she going to try to cheat the curve early on with Emperor Thorason? Either way, she's crafting a plan, and that's a very important factor versus Tansoku. Mirror Image going to set up beautifully to protect that Mana Worm for a long time.
Now, Tansoku's hand looks decent at the start here. He's got a lot of just early removal, which is great, because if you can stifle Temple Mage's board, you can really hamstring them as the game goes on. Frostbolt picked up. Frostbolt doesn't really have any targets. We talked about it. The cheapest minion that Tansoku has in this build is Fandral Staghelm. Everything else is just spells or big, expensive stuff. Rag's not a good pickup.
Yeah, speaking of big expensive stuff, and that Mana Worm is liable to stick around for a while here. Tansoku, I think, going to be forced to simply swipe on this. So if Karakute picks up a strong minion here, I'm thinking Flamewaker, that would either keep the Mana Worm around or threaten more damage alongside it.
Yeah.
That's Flamewaker.
Whoa.
That is a very good draw right now. I'd like to see it hit the board as well. Now, her alternate option is simply to wait and see the swipe and then have the Flamewaker come down afterwards, uncontested in the face of that.
Yeah, but
You don't really have any. I like just building up the board wide, forcing him to have the swiping. Even if he does, you still are left with that mana worm and a mirror image that's still floating at one health. So still a potential. And you can tell she wasn't too upset about that. She's like, okay, well, that's my Flame Waker, but I still have some power turns coming up.
I like the Blood Mage.
Help cycle also presents a threat on the board that, you know, needs attention. You don't want to leave spell power up.
I think there is some consideration for Frostbolt here as well. That would protect your mirror image for an additional turn, and she would actually get 5 damage effectively out of this Frostbolt, both with the Blood Mage powering it up by 1 and with the buff to the Mana Worm as well. So Tansoku, still in a rough spot here, but if he can string together these Feral Rages and buy enough time, that could unlock the power turns.
This could be a big Raven on all. See what he gets. Innervate, Nourish, and Claw.
Not strong pickups. I think Innervate's likely to be the pick here, though. If you look at the way his hand's panning out, Innervate Ragnaros may be enough to either pull a lot of damage from Karakute or just threaten the board position substantially.
Mm. Yeah, Claw doesn't do anything this turn, but it can...
You know, when's Nourish going to get cast this game?
All right, Innervate's the pickup.
And this is an awkward spot when you intend to Innervate Ragnaros in the following turn. I think he's got a Feral Rage for armor and just try to buy as much time as possible. And every single one of those cards he uses, that's one less resource later in the game. His heavy cards are going to have to do the lifting.
Arcane Intellect.
That is a coin Emperor Thorson all day, every day.
Yeah, that is hard to pass up. You saw that Tansoku had trouble removing a Mana Worm on the board. What about a 5-5?
I do not like this. I think Karakute had an open window here to try to seize a tempo, but does find Flame Waker. So now the Emperor Thorson is discounting 2 Frostbolts, Flame Waker, Fireball, and coin was held onto. So that is the trade-off to this, was try to find a big payoff from the Arcane Intellect. She's found it.
Seems like Ragnaros is going to come down this turn. Tansoku can go Ragnaros into either Ancient of War or Arcane Dryad. Probably Ancient of War to start things off to block damage. And then the Aid to follow it up.
This is a really important shot here. That's not what he was looking for.
It's okay. Well, it's better than face or mirror image.
This Emperor Thorson now looks a lot better, I will say. But it would have gotten potentially 5 damage on the previous turn. Maybe she read this as a potential possibility, wanted to protect the Emperors a little bit further. I would think it's the dig for more burn spells and try to one shot.
Hmm.
What to do?
I mean, how many turns do you need to win the game? That's the question. Because if you think you need like 5 or 6 turns to win the game, you might have to kill that rag.
Emperor Thorson all day.
I mean, if you can go.
Look at the hand. If Tansoku wants to cut off one of the potential weakest targets possible, which is a 0-1 taunt, he's got to use his hero power. That stops Ancient of War. That'll stop Arcane Giant. This hand is huge from Karakute. That damage is nigh insurmountable. It's honestly a pretty good draw.
It increases the chances that rag connects on Emperor Thorson, assuming Tansoku wants to go with Ancient of War and stick with his plan.
I mean, he could be eyeing Mulch and Feral Rage.
Mulch and Feral Rage would start allowing him to push damage to face. He could Mulch
the Arcane Giant.
He could Mulch, Feral Rage, and then Moonfire down the Mana Worm and kill off, or Moonfire down the Mirror Image and kill off the Mana Worm, clearing the board. Putting 8 damage into the face.
That's Ancient of War for sure.
Yeah. But, oh man, if this rag does not connect.
This rag
with
hits face, this is a major turn.
Let's see.
Oh my gosh.
Another thumbs up from Karakute.
And a Sorcerer's Apprentice gets drawn.
That's lethal.
That is a lot of damage. Where to direct these burn spells.
I'm just gonna sit back and watch this one. Fireworks display.
Giddy up.
kill the rag now?
No.
Do we kill the face now?
Yeah. That's a good plan. I'm throwing the coin out too.
Coin ping, your Firelands portal next turn.
That's game over.
Yeah, that's the right spot.
Does Tansoku have enough to clear this?
That little mana worm has been doing so much work.
Let's see.
Pump is up to 15.
Heard you, Watchmen. Just get out of here, man.
2-4 at this stage.
It's the Sorcerer's Apprentice, so Flamewaker is still alive.
Now I think there's some merit to Firelands Portal on the Ragnaros here. At this point, it's done some significant damage. You get a little bit of a refund, and Tony gets picked up. That's a lot of fireballs, too.
Yeah. So Kiriki's plan was to coin, or no, doesn't even need to coin, with that Firelands Portal actually is 5 mana with 2 Emperor Reductions.
That's like a Kazakus potion.
Yeah, that's huge. And Living Roots picked up. That's not going to be enough. I think this one's locked up for Karakute.
No contest. Whoa, on the board. Concede. Reverse sweep for Karakute, and now it's up to the tiebreakers at this point.
It's a waiting game. She did the best she could. She moves her record to 5-2, and now it's going to be up to were her opponents strong enough to give her those tiebreaker scores that she needs to make it to the top 8? Tansoku also moves to 5-2, so he's going to be playing that waiting game as well. It's all going to come down to whether or not they can squeak by against all the other 5-2s in the field. But she's ecstatic. Look at that.
Yeah, I mean, what a record to put up. I mean, 5-2, that's a tough record to come by in this field. I mean, there's 69 players playing in the event. Think about how many players are in the entire region. Not only are you one of the competitors that made it this far, but now you're a competitor who's locked up over twice as many wins in rounds as you did in losses. That's a performance to be proud of.
Yeah, but that's got to feel good. And especially, you know, at the end of the day, even though she lost early on, her opponents the last couple rounds have had some good records. Tansoku has a good record. That's sort of a +3 score since Tansoku was 5-2 to her tiebreaker score. So there's a good shot, but again, don't know yet. We're going to get those numbers crunched as round 7, you know, continues on. But now for a look at what's happening throughout the rest of the playoffs and the rest of round 7, Dan and